Welcome to this video tutorial on acute kidney injury. The kidneys are two bean-shaped organs, about the size of a fist, located on either side of the spine just below the rib cage. Their essential function is to regulate body fluid levels and to remove waste products from the blood in the form of urine. They filter about 120 to 150 quarts of blood each day to produce about 1 to 2 quarts of urine, composed of wastes and extra fluid. The kidneys also keep levels of electrolytes stable, such as sodium, potassium, and phosphate. They make hormones that help regulate blood pressure, make red blood cells, and strengthen the bones. Acute kidney injury, or AKI, is a condition in which the kidneys suddenly lose their ability to filter waste from the blood. The term AKI has replaced acute renal failure, or ARF, to reflect that a decline in kidney function does not necessarily lead to organ failure. Acute kidney injury develops rapidly over a few hours to days, causing creatinine and urea to accumulate in the blood, called azotemia, which leads to fluid and electrolyte disorders. AKI is most common in people who are already hospitalized, especially in the critically ill. AKI has a poor prognosis, with the mortality rate ranging from 10 to 80%, depending on the patient population. Patients with uncomplicated AKI have a mortality rate up to 10%. However, patients with AKI and multi-organ failure have a reported mortality rate over 50%. If dialysis or kidney transplant is required, the mortality rate rises to as high as 80%. The risk for developing AKI increases with the elderly, especially in patients with other diseases such as diabetes, cardiac disease, and hypertension. Intensive treatment is required, but full recovery is possible if the condition is caught and treated early. There are three main causes of acute kidney injury. A sudden dramatic drop in blood flow to the kidneys, for example, sepsis or overwhelming infection, is one of the most common causes of AKI. Patients with serious infections have reduced blood pressure, which decreases blood flow to the kidneys, as well as other organs. As blood flow slows, some kidney areas have inadequate blood supply or inadequate perfusion, ultimately leading to cell death. Nephrotoxic drugs, such as aminoglycosides and contrast dyes, can also cause AKI. These drugs must be given carefully to avoid kidney injury. Patients with heart failure, liver disease, diabetes, or a history of AKI are at an increased risk for developing the disease. Acute kidney injury occurs in three types: prerenal, renal, and postrenal. Prerenal injury occurs when there is inadequate perfusion of blood to the kidneys. Renal or intrinsic injury includes diseases affecting the kidney itself. And postrenal injury is generally due to any condition that obstructs the urine flow out of the kidneys, anywhere along the urinary tract. The kidneys receive approximately 1/4 of the cardiac output, resulting in sensitive reactions to changes in perfusion. Prerenal injury occurs when there is inadequate perfusion to the kidneys. In this case, the problem occurs before the blood enters the kidney. The kidneys are actually not receiving enough blood to filter. This is the most common cause of AKI, but does not usually lead to permanent kidney damage if treated in the early stages. The underlying problem of prerenal AKI is due to sepsis, hypovolemia from severe blood loss, dehydration or burns, etc., heart failure, shock or extremely low blood pressure, liver failure, or drugs that decrease blood flow to the kidneys. Renal or intrinsic injury includes diseases affecting the kidney itself. In this case, the damage is done in the kidney tissues and structures. The underlying problem causing this injury to the kidneys is a result of decreased blood supply to the kidneys long enough to damage them, acute tubular necrosis, in which kidney injury is caused by damage to the kidney tubule cells, the most common cause of intrinsic AKI. Acute interstitial nephritis. This is inflammation of the kidneys, usually from an allergic reaction to a drug. Acute glomerular nephritis, which involves inflammation and damage to the glomerular membrane, the filtering screen of the kidney. Acute tubular necrosis, which is kidney injury caused by damage to the kidney tubule cells, the most common cause of postrenal injury is generally due to any condition that obstructs the flow of urine out of the kidneys, anywhere along the urinary tract. The blockage causes pressure to build in all the renal nephrons, which are the filtering units of the kidney, ultimately causing the nephrons to shut down. Postrenal AKI is most often caused by enlarged prostate gland, bladder stones, kidney stones, or it can also be caused by a tumor or cancer in the kidney or bladder, resulting in an obstruction. The signs and symptoms of AKI include the following: fluid retention causing edema in legs, ankles, or feet, weight gain, decreased urine output, although sometimes urine output remains normal, chest pain or pressure, symptoms of uremia, in which urine and other nitrogen waste products build up in the blood, including the following: weakness and fatigue, mental status changes such as confusion, agitation, seizures, and coma, loss of appetite, nausea, or vomiting, abnormal bleeding, heart problems, including irregular heartbeat, pericarditis, chest pain or pressure, shortness of breath from fluid buildup. To clarify, azotemia and uremia both refer to the buildup of nitrogenous waste products, urea and creatinine, in the blood. But azotemia refers to the patient that does not have symptoms, whereas uremia refers to the patient that does have symptoms. Acute kidney injury can be divided into four phases: onset, oliguric, diuretic, and recovery. The onset is the initial phase of injury to the kidney, in which reversal or prevention of kidney dysfunction is still possible. The events that trigger this phase include blood or fluid loss, burns, and diabetes insipidus. The symptoms are often subtle, and the duration usually lasts from hours to days. In the oliguric phase, the urine output usually decreases to less than 400 milliliters per day, so the body is unable to excrete metabolic wastes. This leads to electrolyte disturbances, acidosis, and fluid overload because the kidney is unable to excrete water. The oliguric phase usually lasts from 1 to 3 weeks, but may be longer. The diuretic phase occurs when the cause of AKI is corrected and urine output increases to greater than 1,000 milliliters per day. There may be possible electrolyte depletion from the excretion of more water. Symptoms include a possible urinary output up to 4 to 5 liters per day, postural hypotension, tachycardia, improved mental alertness, weight loss, and thirst. This phase usually lasts 1 to 2 weeks. The recovery phase involves the normalization of fluid and electrolyte balance. Patients have a decrease in edema as well as a decrease in energy levels as the body is recovering, lasting from 3 to 12 months. Most patients are left with some residual renal dysfunction. The diagnostic tests to determine acute kidney injury include blood tests including BUN, creatinine, electrolytes, and CBC, urine tests including sodium, creatinine concentration, urine protein, and microscopic analysis of sediment. Urine output monitoring along with creatinine measurement is currently being studied much more closely, as a fall in urine output directly reflects the GFR, or glomerular filtration rate, in the kidney and therefore is a sensitive and early indication of AKI. Imaging tests including ultrasound, CT, or MRI can help identify the cause of AKI, particularly in postrenal failure, obstructive causes, or hydronephrosis. When the cause of AKI is unknown, a kidney biopsy can also be done. When diagnostic tests are done, you will see the following laboratory results. AKI is marked by increases in blood urea nitrogen, or BUN, and creatinine levels, as well as a decreased urine output to generally less than 40 milliliters per hour. A daily increase in creatinine indicates AKI, and the higher the level, the more severe the decline in kidney function is likely to be. Fluid and electrolyte imbalance occurs in the patient with AKI, the three major problems being hyperkalemia, or elevated potassium, sodium imbalance, and metabolic acidosis. In AKI, many cells in the distal convoluted tubule are not functioning properly, so there is no mechanism to remove potassium from the body. Hyperkalemia develops when the blood serum level of potassium reaches 5.5 milliequivalents per liter or higher. Concentrations can quickly increase to 7 to 10 milliequivalents per liter, which is contradictory to normal cardiac function and life. Potassium toxicity is seen as changes on the ECG, laboratory findings, and occasionally neuromuscular symptoms. Hyponatremia or low sodium in AKI usually develops as a result of overhydration, as the acutely ill, oliguric patient receives numerous fluids and drugs in an attempt to treat life-threatening problems. Serum sodium levels are less than 130 milliequivalents per liter. Signs of hyponatremia include warm, moist, flushed skin, mental status changes such as confusion, delirium, coma, and convulsions, and dialysis may be required to remove the excess fluid and restore sodium balance. Hypocalcemia, or low calcium, is common, as well as hyperphosphatemia, or high phosphorus level. Metabolic acidosis is usually moderate, with the blood pH decreasing and the plasma bicarbonate content decreasing. Central nervous system symptoms of drowsiness, stupor, and coma may appear. Treatment of AKI is supportive. The primary goal is to regain the normal function of the kidney, which usually involves adjusting medications, providing appropriate nutrition, correcting volume status, hyperkalemia, and acidosis. Life-threatening complications such as pulmonary edema and hyperkalemia must be treated immediately in a critical care unit. The ICU allows for constant monitoring of blood pressure, ECG, pulmonary, and mental status. Patients may also require mechanical ventilation and hemodynamic monitoring to monitor intravascular fluid volume. Treatable causes are treated as soon as possible. If obstruction is the cause, a catheter, endoscopy, or surgery may be needed to relieve the obstruction. Nephrotoxic drugs are stopped and drugs excreted by the kidneys are adjusted. If AKI is caused by a lack of fluids, then IV fluids are given. If AKI has caused fluid excess and edema, then daily water intake is restricted. Sodium and potassium intake is minimized. K-exhalate may be given to lower the level of potassium in the blood. It substitutes sodium for potassium in the GI tract. Remember, K, or potassium, exiting. If conservative management is not effective, then dialysis is required. Hemodialysis, often referred to as dialysis, is the process by which blood is removed from the body and waste products are filtered out through a semipermeable membrane. Then the blood is returned to the body. In effect, it works as an artificial kidney when the kidney is not functioning properly. In AKI, dialysis may just be needed temporarily until the kidneys recover their function, usually over several days to weeks. Hemodialysis is needed when severe electrolyte abnormalities cannot be controlled, such as hyperkalemia. Fluid overload with pulmonary edema persists despite drug treatment. Metabolic acidosis is unresponsive to treatment, or symptoms of uremia occur. A healthy diet is important for patients with AKI. A low-protein diet of 0.5 to 0.6 grams per kilogram per day is recommended initially while the GFR is reduced. If dialysis is initiated, protein may be increased to 1 to 1.5 grams per kilogram per day to compensate for protein losses during dialysis. Since protein is restricted, calorie needs may need to be met by increasing carbohydrates and fat in the diet. Calories generally need to be increased to 35 to 50 calories per kilogram to provide positive nitrogen balance under stressful conditions. Salt or sodium is restricted depending on serum sodium levels, urinary excretion, edema, and dialysis needs. Fluid requirements are based on replacing losses of urine, vomit, and diarrhea, plus 500 milliliters per day. If the patient has hyponatremia, sodium is too low, free water is usually restricted. Potassium may be restricted to 1,000 milligrams per day during the oliguric phase, depending on the patient's degree of hypermetabolism due to stress, infection, or fever. Restricting foods high in phosphorus, such as dairy products, liver, legumes, nuts, and most soft drinks, will lower the phosphate concentration in the blood. Nursing guidelines when caring for the patient with AKI include the following. Maintain fluid and electrolyte balance. Maintain fluid restrictions. Monitor IV fluids carefully. Keep accurate records of intake and output. Weigh the patient daily. Monitor vital signs frequently. And monitor serum electrolytes. Maintain nutrition. Provide a diet low in protein and potassium and high in carbohydrates and fat. However, if serum potassium is low, increase potassium intake. Take measures to relieve nausea. Be aware that many patients with AKI are too ill to tolerate oral feedings. Prevent injury. Protect the patient from injury and bleeding. Prevent infection. Avoid sources of infection. Assess for signs and symptoms of infection. Maintain asepsis for indwelling lines or catheters. turn patients every 2 hours and as needed, provide careful skin care and pulmonary hygiene, and facilitate coping, provide emotional support for the patient and family, and promote patient independence. Teach the patient with acute kidney injury about the following: identifying factors that contribute to AKI, such as hypertension and nephrotoxic drugs, prescribed medications, including name of the drug, dosage, the reason for taking, desired effects, and adverse effects, the prescribed dietary guidelines, the risk of hypokalemia or low potassium and the symptoms, including muscle weakness, anorexia, nausea and vomiting, and lethargy, signs and symptoms of returning kidney injury, including a decreased urinary output without decreased fluid intake, signs of fluid retention and weight gain, signs and symptoms of infection and methods to avoid infection, and the importance of follow-up care. Let's go over a review of acute kidney injury. Acute kidney injury is a condition in which the kidneys suddenly lose their ability to filter waste from the blood. There are three main causes of AKI: a sudden dramatic drop in blood flow to the kidneys, nephrotoxic drugs, or a sudden blockage. AKI occurs in three types: prerenal, which occurs when there is an inadequate perfusion of blood to the kidneys; renal or intrinsic injury includes diseases affecting the kidney itself; and postrenal injury is generally due to any condition that obstructs the urine flow out of the kidneys anywhere along the urinary tract. Two common signs of AKI include edema and urinary retention. Acute kidney injury can be divided into four phases: onset, oliguric, diuretic, and recovery. Lab results will show increased BUN and creatinine, increased potassium and phosphorus, decreased sodium and calcium, and metabolic acidosis. Treatment is supportive and depends on the cause of the AKI, sometimes requiring hemodialysis. Provide the patient with a diet low in protein and potassium and high in carbohydrates and fat. Thank you for watching this video tutorial on acute kidney injury, and check out our other videos in the description below.